Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to my presentation about EU General Data Protection Regulation and the impact on that on incident response. So my name is Krijn, hard to pronounce for a lot of you probably. So if you want to call me Mike or whatever you want to call me, feel free to do so. I'm used to that, especially when I'm abroad. For those who don't know Fox IT, it is an organization in the Netherlands, founded in 1999 by our two founders. And I'm part of the threat intel unit. It's divided into two different teams. One of the team is focusing on financially motivated threat actors, and my team is focusing on nation states sponsored groups. Previously, I've been working 8 years for the incident response team and forensics unit of Fox IT. So I have quite a lot of experience with incident response. I became father and realized that it was time to move on and do less incident-driven and ad hoc work. So that's how I became part of the threat intel unit of Fox IT. For those who expect me to be a legal expert, I'm definitely not. So if you have questions about details with regards to GDPR, I can probably not answer that. So I just wanted to let you know that up front. There are a lot of different angles you can look at GDPR, and I will look at GDPR from the incident response perspective. So what we're going to do during this presentation, I will skim through the headlines of GDPR. I will look into the experience we have with data protection in the Netherlands. We implemented the law in the beginning of 2016. That it's basically a law that looks similar to the GDPR, and I will share some observations of us with regards to this particular law, and also reflect on GDPR. Then I will discuss a few case studies with you. And as the last topic, I want to discuss how we can do better or how you can do better with your organization. So, GDPR. GDPR will become effective as of May 25th in 2018. It might sound like we have a lot of time ahead of us, but if you're not really into GDPR, then it might be actually not that much time before it actually becomes effective. And in general, I have to say that what the EU is aiming for is to come up with a law that makes the other laws that we currently have not necessary anymore. So all the EU countries in Europe have their own implementation of data protection. Some are very strict, some are not. Some are very strict but are not really enforced. And the EU wants to replace this all with one regulation, the General Data Protection Regulation. It specifies security requirements for PII. It includes a mandatory data breach notification. I will discuss that later on during the presentation as well. It's pretty high level, like with most regulations. It's telling you basically that you should do something, but not how you should implement it. So it's technology and process agnostic. So one of the headlines of GDPR is privacy by design. And that basically means that when you set up a new information system, that you have to think about all kind of things like how I gonna protect the data in motion, how I gonna protect the data in REST, how are you going to encrypt it, what kind of standards will I use, but also what if a data breach happens, how can I make sure that I can respond effectively and as efficiently as possible. So privacy by design is basically thinking about how to make sure that the privacy is protected and the information is well secured, and that you can also respond adequately to a data breach and keep a data breach as small as possible. So that means that whenever you set up a new information system that is processing data of data subjects, you have to do a privacy impact assessment. You can find all kind of frameworks and checklists for that online, but you have to do a privacy impact assessment. So organizations are required to have a data protection officer. This data protection officer is responsible for making sure that the organization is compliant with GDPR. For the smaller organization, it's probably a role for the compliance officer, who is also taking care of compliancy with regards to other kind of regulations and laws. But this is another headline of the GDPR. There is an opt-in for data collection. The opt-in for data collection basically means that you have to ask for explicit approval to process data of data subjects. And that means that you have to tell what kind of information you want to process and what's the actual purpose of processing this data. So there should be some explicit approval of the data subject to process the information of the data subject. And connected to that is actually also the right to be forgotten. And this is also a very interesting one because this means that you have to erase the information of a data subject in your information system. And what I'm actually wondering is how are they going to enforce that and how strict will they be with regards to the erasure of data? Just an example, what if you have a web shop and there is a data subject that wants to be erased from the information system? It could be as simple as just removing one database record, right? So that would be very simple. But you probably also have daily backups, weekly backups, monthly backups, all kind of backup tapes. And are you also taking that into account? Are you also going to erase that kind of information from the backup tapes? Maybe that's not necessary, and maybe they will not be that strict. But I know from my experience with incident response and my work as a forensic expert that it can be quite hard to erase data. And erasing data is also not equivalent to wiping data. For example, we did a case in the Netherlands a couple of years ago for an organization that is printing passports. And in these passports, they include fingerprint information. And there were questions by politicians in the Dutch parliament about how they erase that data, what kind of methods do you use, how good do you erase the data, how thoroughly are you? And as you might know, once it is discussed in parliament, that means that there is a lot of political pressure. So that's one of the reasons why they hired a third party to investigate that. So the system they were using for requesting new passports consisted out of three other systems. So there was the fingerprint scanner, you had the workstation, and the server that was collecting all the information. And the fingerprint scanner itself was a kind of black box, so we couldn't really do anything with it. But the fingerprint information was transferred to the workstation, so it ended up on a file system. And there was also a process running on this workstation that was processing the fingerprint information. That means also that it ends up in memory. And the fact that it could end up in memory also means that it could end up in a page file. Some information is that small that it can end up in the master file table. And there were so many different kind of places where this information could end up. And what the politicians asked us to do to come up with a method to wipe the information from all these different kind of places. So it's really hard to do. It's really time consuming. It's also expensive to do so. And I'm actually wondering how this will be implemented in the end and what this requires from the organizations who are processing data for data subjects. So as mentioned already, there is a mandatory data breach notification. You have 72 hours to notify the data protection authority. And it might seem a little bit or that you don't have that much time to notify the DPA. But on the other hand, if you are well prepared and if you have all the information in place to do an investigation and to do proper incident response, then it might be sufficient to do the investigation within 72 hours. At least you have to notify the DPA as when you know that the breach occurred. And after the 72 hours, you still have time to further continue your investigation and amend the original notification and provide extra context after the 72 hours. Another big change for a lot of European countries is the fact that they increased fines. So they have two categories. One is a fine of 10 million or 2% of your global turnover, or the highest category with a fine of 20 million or 4% global turnover. So that can be a lot of money you have to pay to the EU if you're not compliant with their regulation. This is another concept they introduced with GDPR, the one-stop shop. That basically means that if you're a multinational who is operating in different kind of EU countries, if you do that now, you have to deal with different kind of EU laws and EU data protection laws. So that makes it a little bit difficult because you have to take all these laws into account. But they will that will change with GDPR, and that means that if you're a multinational, you're processing information of EU citizens in different EU countries, that when a data breach occurs, you only have to deal with just one DPA, who will make sure that it's coordinated with all the other DPAs in Europe. So that's the principle of the one-stop shop. All right. Let's look at the Dutch situation, because we implemented the law, and that became effective actually January 1st of 2016. So we have some kind of experience with a lot of concepts from GDPR. We had already a Data Protection Act in since the beginning of 2000 that was based on the EU directive from 1995. This directive was by a lot of EU countries implemented in their national law. So we had already a Data Protection Act, and they updated that one in January 1st, 2016. So it's basically an extension of existing laws, and a few new topics were covered. The mandatory data breach notification, that's similar to GDPR, and the increased fines. So the maximum fine is now 820,000 euros, or 10% of your domestic turnover. So a lot of topics were already previously covered by the previous Data Protection Act, and these were also included in the new Data Protection Act. So, became December 2015 in the Netherlands, and there were already a lot of discussions throughout 2015 about the new Data Protection Act. So you would have expected that most organizations knew about the fact that the new act would become effective the 1st of January in 2016. But actually that was not the case. So a lot of organizations in December 2015 reacted in disbelief, disgust, and well, they were definitely not okay with this new Data Protection Act we have in the Netherlands. And they actually realized that there was a mandatory data breach notification, so they have to notify a DPA, they have to apply privacy by design, and all other kind of concepts. But the fact is that they should have been already compliant with the law since the beginning of 2000, because a lot of these topics were already covered in the previous privacy law, but no, or at least a lot of organizations were not doing anything with that act and were not compliant with that. And one of the main reasons actually has to do with the previous slide. I mentioned already that they increased the fines to 820,000 euros as a maximum fine, but with the act from 2000, they didn't really have tools to enforce that law because the maximum fine in the previous law was 4,500 euros. And it didn't matter what kind of organization you were, who big you were, how much revenue you made, how many employees were working for you. their maximum fine was 4,500 euros. So that's a horrible fine to enforce a law, right? So actually nobody cared about the Data Protection Act and didn't do that much with it. And that changed, of course, since the beginning of 2016. So this is basically the same as for GDPR. You have 72 hours to notify the DPA. You have to inform, depending on the situation, the data subjects that are affected by the breach. And the rest is actually the same as we have, or what's in the GDPR regulation. An interesting thing about our law is, and that's in general the case with laws, is how something is written in the law and how it's interpreted in the end. And in the Dutch Data Protection Act, there is a phrase that says a data breach is a breach of security that leads to a significant possibility of serious negative consequences for the protection of PII. That's what the law says. The way it's interpreted is a data breach occurs when a security incident involves the loss of personal identifying information, and then there comes the most important part of it, or when the unauthorized processing of PII cannot be ruled out beyond reasonable doubt. Oh, that's an interesting one, because it's not like you have to prove that something has happened. You have to prove that nothing has happened. Otherwise, you have to notify the DPA. And that's also important with regards to incident response, and I will discuss this later on also when we're going to discuss the things we can learn from this. So we have now a little more than 1 year experience with the new Data Protection Act in the Netherlands, which looks similar to GDPR. And what we as a forensics and incident response observed were the following issues. Most organizations weren't actually prepared for this new act. Most of them had the mentality like, we're going to cross that bridge when we get there, and we're not going to prepare at all. So during the incident response cases, very limited data was available, and therefore it took a lot of time to find the actual root cause. Most organizations didn't have that much of log files or relevant traces. And the problem was that they could not prove that something happened, but also not the other way around, that they could not prove that something did happen. So most organizations were actually quite ill prepared for incident response, and it took them a really long time to respond effectively. So here are a few case studies. I will outline cases we did in the past year. And the first one is actually a quite interesting one. It's about a stolen laptop. It's not that entertaining. It's just a laptop that has been stolen, and that's pretty much it, you know? This organization forgot to do a privacy impact assessment, so they didn't have encryption. And their core process is basically processing medical information. And it could be possible that the medical information was on the laptop. So we did the intake interview with the CEO of this organization. He was almost crying, and he said, yeah, okay, this laptop has been stolen, and now we have to notify the DPA. That's one thing. But we also have to, we think at least, we have to notify the data subjects, because probably there was medical information on this laptop. But we don't have the laptop anymore, so how do we know we should notify about the fact that this information has gone missing? So what he asked us to do is whether we could help them with finding out what kind of information was on this laptop. And what we did was actually a kind of e-discovery investigation, where we secured the mailbox of the person this laptop belonged to, and we created a copy of the home directory of this person and the department file shares he had access to, extracted the PII information, and informed the data subjects that were part of these data sets. Maybe there were persons who were not residing or were data subjects who were not actually on this laptop, or data from persons who weren't existing on this laptop, but we had to inform them, all. So it's just a really simple case about a stolen laptop, but it can have quite an impact if you don't do a privacy impact assessment. So this seems also quite a boring one, you know? It's about a defaced website. It's not that exciting, actually. So a company's website was defaced, and the website was hosted in the cloud. And they had a cloud hosting party who was doing that for them. And this party was also doing that for a lot of other organizations. They used a database cluster, and the databases of all these websites were hosted in this cluster. And one of the websites of one of the other organizations they were hosting the website for became compromised, was an SQL injection. So they ended up in the database belonging to that website, and because they had access to one database and misconfigured the whole cluster, it meant that the threat actor basically had access to all the databases on this cluster. So we know that the threat actor had access and altered the database because the website was defaced, so he had to be in the database. But the question is whether he also had access to PII of the data subjects. So we started asking about, do you have any log files, full packet capture data, and those kind of things. But this organization who was hosting this website didn't have that at all. So in the end, they couldn't prove that something had happened with the data. So they ended up with a notification to the DPA, and they ended up with informing all the data subjects in their information system. That wouldn't have been necessary if they have done a privacy impact assessment, but since they haven't done that, it meant that they had to inform everyone. And this is the most funny one, actually. It's about a municipality in the Netherlands, and one of the IT administrators was sifting through the firewall logs just for debugging purposes. I don't know actually why he was going through the firewall logs, but he was doing that, and he found a log line, and this log line indicated, at least to him, that they were compromised by a threat actor, and that 20 gigabytes of information had been stolen from their network. He downloaded a forensic tool, and he started analyzing with this tool the firewall logs. And this tool told him, "You are compromised, and 20 gigabytes of data had been stolen." So what they did was, they notified the DPA that they had a data breach, and they also drafted a press statement and said, "Sorry guys, we have been breached. Sorry for that, 20 gigabyte of data has been stolen, and just so you know." So yeah, that was basically the press statement. And then they asked us to verify their findings and to look into the same log files. And what we quickly found out is that the tool they used to analyze these firewall logs was not well programmed, and there were a few mistakes. And basically, all the attacks were dropped on the firewall, so nothing happened. And then they drafted a new press statement and said, "Okay, yeah, sorry, we made a mistake. Nothing happened. Move along. Go on with your life. We're fine." So if we look at these three cases, and there are way more examples of these kind of organizations, none of them was really prepared for the new Data Protection Act. They haven't done anything with a privacy impact assessment. And that means that all of them shouldn't have notified their data subjects if they were well prepared for incident response and well prepared for this Data Protection Act. So now they all risk the fine. They all risked an impact on their reputation just because they weren't well prepared for this Data Protection Act. So how can you do better? And I said already, I will focus on incident response. And when you look at the physical world, then we're quite used to implementing all kind of physical preventative measures if you want to protect, for example, your building, right? So you have, like, for example, locks you can use. You can place fences around your building. You can do all kind of other things like place a guard with a dog in the direct neighborhood of your office building. So we're used to quite a lot of preventative measures in the physical world. But we also know that it's not a question of if, but a question of when you become compromised. And that's one of the reasons why we in the physical world have alarm systems. Because we know that a burglar might trespass all our preventative security measures, and therefore it's recommended to use an alarm system. And that's also what a lot of insurance companies, for example, requires you to do if you want to get money back from your insurance company in case they steal something. Not a lot of organizations use the digital equivalent of an alarm system within their organization, and that's basically an IDS. So our experience is that detection is king, and that early detection in general leads to better responses. It also helps you to build up some data retention that will help you to more effectively and efficiently respond to a data breach. Like, if we go to an organization who became breached, we place most of the time network sensors in their network, and then we have 7 days of full packet capture data and 1 year of metadata that we could use to find out what actually happened and also prove that something has not happened. So this is a more generic slide that you have to prepare, but you figured that probably already out because I mentioned already quite a few times in this presentation. It's important that that you improve your people technology and in the end process. So you have to train people to deal with these kind of data breaches and to deal with these kind of cases. You need to have the right technology in place, or at least configure the technology in the right way. And you need process to glue this all together and make sure that it all works. Other than that, it's good to set a goal for the next years, or because it's not a 2 week kind of project and after that you're finished. For a lot of organizations who haven't done anything with incident response or response readiness, this will probably be a couple of year project. So measure the gap and create a goal to improve. I use the example of this municipality in the Netherlands, and a lot of organizations tend to believe that if there's an IT administrator who knows how to deal with computers, he's also probably capable of doing incident response cases and being a forensic expert. Well, my experience is that most of the time that's not the case, and they mess up a lot of traces and draw conclusions that they shouldn't draw. And yeah, so you might need to have experts, and those experts could be in your organization itself, so internal experts, but it could also be external experts, and that's why you have, for example, incident response retainers. And also, a lot of organizations believe that if a data breach happens or an incident happens, that it is a kind of technical nerdist festivity. Of people who should look into the actual root cause of this incident. And of course, it is partially technical incident response cases and data breaches, but you also need to have different kind of profiles. So you need a multidisciplinary team, including technical people, legal people, PR, accounting, and you can probably come up with a lot of other profiles. And if you don't want to build up your own capability, your own incident response capability, please make sure you have a retainer and that you have these guys on their speed dial and that you signed a SLA. The last bullet is also very important. I will outline that in one of the next slides. I mentioned this one already. So what you should do as an organization to be prepared for GDPR is look around at your organization. What kind of systems do you have, internal and external, that process PII from data subjects? And if you know which systems do that, then make sure that you find out what the actual most variable log data is to respond to a data breach. And if you know what the most variable log data is, find out what the actual retention should be. For some organization, that's a year. For other organizations, prefer to store that for 2 years. But those are two important things to take into account with regards to your own information systems. Another topic that a lot of organizations forget is they collect all these log files and they store it locally on the on the file system of the information system itself, but they don't think about the integrity of data. So if you collect that data, make sure it ends up in for example, a log file, or make sure that you calculate MD5 or SHA-1 sums just to make sure you can prove that the integrity of the data is good. So the integrity of data is important, otherwise your data becomes useless. What we saw in the case study of the organization where the website became defaced is that information can also be processed externally. So you have to apply or make sure that the external suppliers who are processing data for you are also compliant with GDPR. So make sure that you have the right information available even though it's external. And in the long term, you might consider a CMOR and IDS because that has really speed up the problem or the process, at least that is my experience. And in general, if you think about what should I log, to what extent should I log it, what should be the retention, think about how you can prove that nothing has happened. So I used already a few examples of physical security measures we have. And one of the other things is, for example, fire drills. We're quite used to fire drills, right? You've probably done it in elementary school, secondary school, high school, and you're probably still doing it within your own organization. And I think that's quite useful because in the end, what you try to achieve with a fire drill is that as less people die as possible, right? So you want to be you want to be able to respond as effectively and efficiently to a fire. And since we're used to that in the physical world, it would also be a good idea to translate that concept to the virtual situation and do actual dry runs of crisis situations and include all the different kind of key stakeholders to make sure that they are also part of that process. And you can do it in a lot of different ways. You can do it paper-based, you can have fancy simulators or whatever you like, but in the end, you have to dry run the actual scenario or the incident response case. And then you will end up with very valuable information about where you are lacking the right procedures or the right processes or where you are lacking information just to respond quickly to a data breach. One important thing is that you have to create an open atmosphere while doing these dry runs. I have some experience with that. I've done it with approximately 50 different kind of organizations in the past 2 years. And one organization, for example, there we did a dry run with the IT department, and we did a dry run with the upper management of the organization. We used the output of the dry run with the IT department in the dry run with the upper management. And one guy was actually in both sessions, and that was the head of IT. And during the first session with the IT department, they came up with all kind of things that were not in place, were not working, processes they didn't have. But all of a sudden, in the week after that session, when we did it with the upper management, everything was solved and everything was working, and nothing was mentioned about things that weren't actually correct implemented. Anyway, you need to have, and that was just because he was afraid to lose face or to lose or get a bad reputation. So you need to have a open atmosphere where criticism is taken seriously and handled appropriately. And yeah, in general, it would be good if you can use the output, of course, in other kind of process, and that you can improve the actual situation. So what can you do with what I've told you today? Straight away, you can think about incidents you have seen in your organization in the past. So that's one thing, and you can probably learn a lot from that. You can ask yourself questions like, were the right people involved? Were all the key stakeholders covered? Did we have all the information or not? Do we have the right agreements with external data processors? And all those kind of questions, and then use that information to identify key stakeholders and make sure that you involve them in the improvement plan. You can do, based on that, also a detailed gap analysis. You can use different kind of standards for that. So the sense critical security controls are mentioning logging of data, data retention, and those kind of things. So you can use different kind of standards to help with a gap analysis of your situation. So that's something you can do on the short term. On the more long term, for the next 6 months, if you want to take it seriously, make sure you have a project owner. Prioritize the potential issues and the things you want to improve, especially since when you are quite unprepared at the moment. You might need to prioritize a little bit, because it can take quite a while before you actually have improved everything and implemented everything. So I think a roadmap would be a good idea if your organization is pretty unprepared for incident response and GDPR. And make sure that you have people who are responsible for specific tracks within in your roadmap. And of course, the last one is trivial, I think. And I think everyone agrees that if there is no buy-in from the upper management, then there is a big chance that it might fail. So to summarize my presentation, we have 1 year of experience with a Data Protection Act that looks similar to GDPR. Actually, nobody cared about it, and most of the organizations weren't prepared. So you can do a lot better, and you can make sure that you are prepared. So please do, and make sure that you have all the right information in place to react as efficiently and effectively to a data breach. And that will also help you to make sure that you can inform your DPA as fast as possible within the 72 hours. And on the other hand, this will also help you to avoid the risk of getting a very high fine, as well as informing unnecessarily data subjects. So that's the bottom line of my presentation. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, please let me know.